radioembolization has been an iterative process over the, I'll say, last two decades or so, and has really taken a role throughout most of the stages in the Barcelona Clinic Liver Cancer Guideline, from very early stage all the way through the advanced stage. And so we've seen it really evolve into really three primary forms of treatment: for curative intent, for a bridging downstaging treatment, as well as for palliative treatment in the intermediate and the advanced stage. Let's say when you compare it to ablative modalities, there really isn't a size restriction per se with radioembolization, nor are we limited by location. And so areas near the dome and critical structures, heart and lungs and bowel, are not as affected with radioembolization, with radiation segmentectomy, as it is with ablation. And we know now with the legacy trial that the results are quite good, and we're approaching curative intent in that space. And the same goes when you compare it with another transarterial form of therapy, whether it's chemoembolization or bland embolization, where the recently published article looking at complete pathologic necrosis with doses greater than 400 gray was virtually 100% in a subset analysis of a legacy trial. And so I think we're looking at, you know, much higher rates of not only complete pathologic necrosis, but also complete responses according to modified RECIST. Recently, UNOS has changed their criteria again for liver transplantation, and in the United States has implemented acuity circles. And so what this has really changed is the fact that across the board, meaning within the United States, patients are waiting much longer for transplantation who have T2 priority with HCC. And so what radioembolization allows compared to, for instance, chemoembolization, is a much longer local recurrence rate or time to progression compared to chemoembolization. And this is really an advantage when it comes to bridging and downstaging patients to transplantation. In New York, in our practice, we have a very large referral base for HCC for transplantation. And so this is critical to give patients a shot at a true cure, which would be transplantation. And we also have it as destination therapy, where patients come, maybe do not want surgical resection, and are offered radiation segmentectomy as an alternative to resection in our practice. And of course, we also use it in combination with immuno-oncologic therapies such as checkpoint inhibitors for palliative purposes, again, either in the intermediate or the advanced stage with vascular invasion. Patient selection is critical when it comes to any form of local regional therapy. And this, of course, applies to radioembolization as well. When we look at all the literature, the majority of patients are Child Pugh A to B, or have an ALBI score that is favorable for patient outcomes. We also really limit our treatments to performance status ECOG 0 to 1. And those we know are the patients that really do the best with our therapies. Again, also limiting the amount of disease. Certainly unilobar disease patients with surgical principles in mind for radioembolization tend to do the best. But certainly select patients who are bilobar, where you have limited disease, can also benefit tremendously from radioembolization. I think we're waiting on some pivotal trials to read out probably later this year. And so there are also trials in the works that are going to see if we can really implement radioembolization in first-line therapy. In our practice, from a practical standpoint, it's already integrated as first-line therapy for curative intent, as well as for bridging and downstaging in the very early and the early stage. And again, we have used it for many years as first-line therapy for patients in the advanced stage with vascular invasion. And I believe that that is reflected in many practices. And despite the systemic therapies that have read out, not all patients are eligible for instance, a Atezo-Bev, in the advanced stage, either due to portal hypertension or other comorbidities or side effect profile. And so I think that radioembolization in this subset of patients should be first-line therapy, as Dosisphere has shown a tremendous benefit in patients who are dosed appropriately and targeted for the vascular invasion.